Parental discretion is advised.
Find yourself in the Beachview area of Pittsburgh? Check out the official pizza of this show, Slice on Broadway, sharing an abnormal obsession with pizza we can relate to. Check them out at sliceonbroadway.com and tell them this show sent you. Hey guys, it's the Wrestling Mayhem Show 494. Ready to talk professional wrestling. I'm Mike Sorg at Sorgatron on the Twitters here in the Mayhem Studios here in Pittsburgh, PA. And we got a great, great night here lined up for you with the Indie Mayhem Show. There's going to be a lot of Lucha Underground talk. I can tell you that right now, especially if you have maybe already or plan to check out the other show. And we'll get right into it. First of all, in the studio, that's Eamon. Well, that's not Eamon. Okay, there's Eamon in San Antonio because I slipped and there he is. Hi, Eamon.
Hi, Sorg.
Okay. Well. I wasn't ready for that. But also yep. In the studio, as I was trying to say, is a mainstream Matt Carlins.
What's happening, Sorgatron? You know what? You know what the best part about coming down to the Sorgatron Media Studios? You always find something new.
Oh, no.
I didn't even know we had this. But we do! We have this now.
That is a prop from, and I think it might be on this week's or next week's Sawtooth Willie. It was
donated. Speak nonsense to me, Scott Steiner doll. Yes. All right.
You'll get it going and it won't shut up. I think Andrew Pallas was playing with that on the show a couple weeks ago.
I should get rid of it then.
You gross, man.
But also with us from, I don't know if I set him up right. This might just be me. Oh, no, there he is. Mad Mike from Poughkeepsie, New York. The only one of us with a not cease and desist. Future Endeavor letter from WWE.
That is true. And also the only one who now knows everyone's favorite member of Earth, Wind & Fire.
That's right. And to know what that's about, you need to be a Patreon supporter like our good friend from El Paso, Texas. He's from thewrestlingrevolution.com. He is Antonio Garza.
Hey, Sorga. I read on the dirt sheets that this is going to be a Lucha Underground themed day, so I used my Patreon on the bank briefcase to get myself in the show.
That's right, hanging out with us here. And we'll see how the evening goes because it's already a little bit surprising. So, of course, you can check us out. We're at WrestlingMayhemShow.com. You can find this and other shows, including the great, great articles that that Matt Carlins is actually putting up there. Matt, what did you talk about this week?
This week on the Wrestling Mayhem Show in my weekly column, we discussed one of the 19 new recruits that signed their developmental deals with WWE. And his name is Daniel Matha. And he has some ties here to Western PA. He grew up in Erie. He played a little football at Pitt. Played a little football at IUP, Indiana University of Pennsylvania, Division II, if you're down with that. And, he kind of reinvented himself. And this homie is on the fast track, Sorg. I'll tell you something. So go to WrestlingMayhemShow.com, read all about him. You'll be amazed how quickly someone can go from a football career to a professional wrestling career.
Awesome. And it was getting a lot of reaction, I know, on the Reddit forums and everything under the Squared Circle subreddit. I'm trying to get into the Reddits. Garza, actually, big thanks to Garza for helping me out getting into Reddit. And I suitably got banned already. So that got interesting. I need to read the rules and not use scripts to post things from the Mayhem Show. Apparently, that's a bad thing. And I learned the hard way. But anyways, I think I got everybody here, but also, you can check us out and drop us a line and let us know your thoughts. 412-206-WMS0 is the hotline, as the Carlins ranted and raved on a few weeks ago, or hit us up on the email address, goodtimes@wrestlingmayhemshow.com. Yes. And as I mentioned, you can also become a friend on the Patreons, patreon.com/wrestlingmayhemshow. Like Garza does, he is our earliest of, even though it doesn't reflect because it kind of goofed up a little bit, but he is our earliest Patreon user. A user? No, our patron. What's the proper word for me? What do you prefer to be called? What are your people?
El Patron.
Yeah, supporter sounds really good.
Okay. The supporters on the Patreon, including I can't remember. It keeps going in the chat room. I keep forgetting. It's the... Is it the Carlins Family Fund to support podcasting or something?
the Matthew and Jennifer Carlins Foundation for Podcast Betterment or something like that.
That's amazing. That's
like
amazing.
PBS in here.
And also, Edward Burke, as talks with us a lot on the Twitters, has been supporting us, as well as Bo Diggity. So thank you so much for everybody supporting this show and helping to better our podcast experience for all. Okay, let's get into it with our discussion topics for this week. First, let's talk a little bit about Survivor Series. We got a glimpse of it last night on Monday Night Raw, which, by the way, I was not on the Raw wrap, but I didn't get a chance to see what you guys said about it. But I got a chance to watch it this morning because it was at a wrestling-related Insane Clown Posse concert, which, by the way, started with I Want to Be a Hulkamaniac and an Ultimate Warrior intro.
So, Warrior was there?
No, but no, they did full-on strobe light Ultimate Warrior intro of them coming out. So that was pretty awesome. Wow. But so that was my wrestling-related thing. Oh, plus JCW champion The Weed Man was there, and as was Facade, but he was just in the crowd with me. But anyways, so the Survivor Series was last night. I thought it was a lot of fun. I thought the show in general was a lot of fun. Mike, you had a take on this that you wanted to touch on here.
Yeah, now, they showed a retrospective of Survivor Series.
Right.
Last night on Raw. They showed the first one from 1987. Then they jumped all the way up to, like, 2005. And then they went right to last year's, where they very stealthily cut Sting out of the entire video.
They did, didn't they?
Yes, they did. They cut Sting out of the entire video. But it made me realize, like, I don't know if it's the fact that you don't need to show that many replays of Survivor Series stuff, or the fact that they jumped from 1987 to 2005-ish. Do we need the Survivor Series-style match anymore? I mean, because back in the day, it used to be fun. Like, we'd get together four or five weirdos on each team, and whoever was feuding with who, and we'd put them against each other, and we'd have fun with that. They'd all have wacky names and everything like that. But they haven't done that in years. And, like, it's always, like, Team Orton or Team Cena. And none of those are exciting. Like, unless it's Team Jon Stewart.
Right.
Like, it wouldn't really be intriguing because we see big matches like that all the time now. So I'm just like, I mean, I still like the Survivor Series. I would personally prefer if they go back to the old school style where we have the cheesy names for all the teams and everything like that. I think Stardust especially could do something like that this year. But I mean, I don't know if it really matters anymore.
That's the thing. Like, back then was when you didn't see these guys together, right? Like, this is back when we had jobber matches every week. So when you saw, like, all these guys mixing it up, it was something special. And I think it's kind of hard for you to establish that in these days when we get main event matches every week on Raw. I mean, really, you know, the war kind of destroyed that for us, right? So I think it's a lot harder. It's a lot harder to make it important. So that's why we get SmackDown versus Raw or Team Authority has a giant stipulation. Holy crap, you know? And then they went and did bragging rights, which I thought, like, diffused it even more a little bit, right? So I don't know. I'm with you. I love the concept, but it's just never going to have the air that it did back in the 80s and early 90s.
I kind of feel like they need to get back to, like, the way I kind of remember some of these Survivor Series matches is it was kind of like an opportunity for a wrestler who's at a certain level to kind of, like, jump up to maybe a slightly higher level. So Hulk Hogan would have guys on his team that really had, like, no business being near Hulk Hogan during his match, right, Sorg? There'd be like
right.
Tito Santana right. would show up on his Survivor Series team.
Right.
And that was always, like, a cool thing to see guys kind of, like, I don't know, out of their depth a little bit. And even when they do, like, they've done Survivor Series matches, traditional Survivor Series matches the last couple of years, and it's usually basically the normal main event, upper main event guys. Although I'm going to undercut my whole argument because I remember now that Eric Rowan was on Team Cena last year. And that was kind of a classic case. But, you know, they were doing something with him. But that was kind of a fun thing to do. So I think that would be a kind of a neat way to kind of reinvigorate the traditional Survivor Series match now. If you had, like, for example, you know, John Cena leading a team and he just happened to have to, like, pluck Zack Ryder from obscurity again to be his fourth guy. You know, that would be kind of interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I don't know. Like, I mean, you could have someone lead Team NXT against Team WWE.
Have a real invasion kind of situation.
Yeah, like, it doesn't even have to be an invasion. It could be someone who, like, represents NXT, like Neville. Neville would be a good fit. Like, he could pick three guys. Like, he could get into a fight with someone who rejects everything that happened in NXT, like Seth Rollins.
I want to touch
on something like that. I don't know.
I want to touch on now, Eamon. You're somebody now. We're growing up on. We remember when Survivor Series was just Survivor Series matches, and I remember a certain sense of betrayal when we had a main event of Hulk Hogan against the Undertaker the 1 year. I'm like, what? This isn't just all Survivor Series matches.
What the hell's going
What's happening? And it just got worse. Right now, I don't know if you have as much of an attachment to this concept as you may a Royal Rumble. Because of that, because of your age, what is your take on the Survivor Series as a whole?
I don't know. I feel like, in kind of in contrast, the way you feel, like my favorite Survivor Series like pay per view matches I can think of are Survivor Series matches. You know what I mean?
Right.
Not to say that any of those matches are bad, but from what I at least can tell from like the older stuff, like around the time you guys were mentioning, was that. And then maybe sometimes it was the case, but it wasn't necessarily even people in feuds necessarily. Like it was just collections of wrestlers. Maybe there was like a light feud or something like that to like hype the match or something. But like, not like, you know, these weren't like blood rivals, you know, necessarily. As opposed to like last year when we saw the whole Authority thing with Cena. And there's an aspect to where I like that. I feel like in the case of the idea Mike suggested about doing NXT versus WWE, it doesn't even have to be like a feud thing. It doesn't have to be like an invasion thing. It can just be them saying, hey, we got this cool concept. We're going to take five guys from NXT, five of NXT's best, put them against five of WWE's best. And that sells itself, I feel.
That's true.
I think it just comes from a fact of, and it's mentioned a lot in like reports and stuff like that, but a lot of the feel is that Vince McMahon doesn't really like the Survivor Series concept anymore. I feel like there was 1 year where he was like, he mentioned something like in some sort of like conference call where he was thinking of dropping the whole show.
I think, but I remember that. That was just a few years ago, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And, you know, it's obviously been extremely de-emphasized, but, you know, I feel like that's the case of it more than anything. Like, and from what I remember, like, I believe Survivor Series was originally created to compete against Starrcade,
right?
Basically,
right.
Like, so I, like you said, that combined with the whole Monday Night War stuff, and then yeah, it's really not needed anymore. But yeah, I love the idea of the match, but you just gotta put a certain, you know, you gotta build it a certain way. I mean, maybe they're trying to do that, but I don't know.
Maybe you do something interesting, like Survivor Series ends up being like in a cage. It's just Survivor Series in a cage instead of just doing War Games. Because that's
War Games.
They're never going to do War Games because they didn't make War Games, right? So, yeah. I don't know. That's my take.
Do you remember the 1 year that, and I probably bring this up every year around the time Survivor Series is on, but I don't care because it's such a cool concept.
Right.
They had an Ultimate Survivors match.
Right. Yeah, we're all like, the winners. Like
how about this? You take the WWE champion and you say, all right, Seth, you've beaten everyone in WWE. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to set up, let's say, three Survivor Series matches, all 5-on-5 traditional. Whoever is the surviving members from the winning team, they will all be thrown in a multi-man match for the WWE title.
Like a fatal X way, whatever that is going
to
be.
Yeah, just like, and don't call it a scramble, just call it one fall to a finish. Like, something like that, because then you keep the WWE champion out of it, you can build new feuds, like, you can have stuff happen that kind of makes it interesting.
Not only that, remember when they used to do that whoever team won would be the general manager for the next month? Yeah, they did that one year, yeah.
Right.
That was a cool concept. I like that there is some sort of stake in it. Even if it's like I can't do it now, obviously, but I like the idea of like there being like even like a trophy or something along those lines. Like even something small like that would be, you know,
I want to point out that I believe that match led to Maven being general manager for a week.
I was going to say, literally just going to say, Maven was general manager for a week.
Yeah, that was probably the highlight between that and Undertaker beating him up, you know, so, wow.
The best Survivor Series matches are the ones where there are stakes. I mean, we get nostalgic about these old Survivor Series matches with Hogan and Warrior and stuff, but they, you know, I don't remember anything about them. They were probably all terrible. But the good Survivor Series matches were the ones that actually had some stakes. So you had the one where the two teams fought to see who would get to be general manager. Team Austin versus Team Bischoff is not just one of the best Survivor Series matches really of all time. It might be like one of the best matches of the 2000s, that decade, period. It's amazing. It's like masterclass Shawn Michaels.
I do.
And also, Team WWE versus Team Alliance.
Mm-hmm.
Team WWE versus Team Alliance for the control of the company.
Yeah, the winner take all. So they've had some awesome Survivor Series matches when there has been something at stake. You need something at stake.
And I don't mind the ones of older years when it was like creative teams and stuff like that. I hated like later years when it was just there's five different feuds going on, put each of the sides of the feuds in the match. You know, it's lazy, and then you're just doing the match just to do the match. You know.
Yep.
Yeah, it's funny. Like I just realized this as we were talking about it. So I was thinking, hey, wait, I've been to a Survivor Series. My favorite Survivor Series is Survivor Series 2002. Right. It has no traditional Survivor Series match on it.
Yeah. Right, right.
I think the only thing that was like sort of like it was, wasn't there like a tables elimination thing?
Yeah, there was a six-man tables elimination with a three-minute warning and Rico versus the Dudleys and Jeff Hardy.
Oh, man.
Oh, yeah, it was fun.
Can I remind you guys of Survivor Series? The Deadly Game!
Yeah,
that too.
It had its own theme song. It was amazing back then, and it was the tournament to crown a new champ, I think. And that's the they did a double turn with Mankind and Rock, and the Rock won.
And it also had the one of my all time favorite moments from that Attitude Era when Shane McMahon, who's been set up as like the good guy all the way going into the Survivor Series, comes running in during I think Austin's match presumably count the pinfall for Austin. He goes 1-2 and he stops, and they cut away the shot of Austin, and Austin looks like he's like Brian Pillman is back from, you know, the afterlife, and it just popped in. He's like complete shock on his face. It's just fantastic.
Awesome. Well, we'll see what's going on. What do they make out of the Survivor Series? Of course, we got a lot going on, as we're going to discuss in a moment, with Undertaker and Bray Wyatt, which really feels like a Survivor Series kind of situation. It could be, but there's some other stuff going on there. So it'd be very interesting to see how that kind of stuff kind of pans out here. But we're going to talk about magic and mysticism in a moment here in professional wrestling. And maybe you can talk about some lucha partially in there as well. But first, I want, you know, hey, you know what's magical? You know what's magical, guys?
What, Sorg?
No, that's the wrong ad. Indie wrestling is magical, guys.
That too.
We're all right, Sorg.
Yeah, that's right. Everybody's correct. We, of course, us over at the indiewrestling.us. There's a lot of great stuff. We got Best of Dalton Castle going on right now. We have some new stuff from Border City Wrestling that you can check out. Individual
the
matches.
New Japan stuff, man.
A lot of people are buying the lady matches, I'm noticing. So you can get your lady matches. Go in there, check out the last couple IWC and RWA shows. We got individual matches for all of those. We got Bloody Harvest with Jason Gory taking on Amazing Red and Sanjay Dutt, but just burnt the house down. It was freaking amazing. And also some great cuts. Yes, great stuff like Prime Cuts. We're actually working on a new one about superstars with all kinds of people, and Rhino and Raven and Virgil and Gregor Hammer, Valentine, Tito Santana, some of the names we just mentioned from the good old Survivor Series days. That'll be coming up here in the coming weeks, hopefully. But you can check out ones like Shima Zion, a best of from all this stuff from up in Cleveland that a lot of people probably haven't seen unless you had TV in Cleveland back in the day, or Matt Cross or Gregory Iron, One Armed and Dangerous Gregory Iron. A lot of great stuff there. Go check it out. IndieWrestling.us, digital downloads, some DVD releases on there as well for RWA and IWC. And sign up for the newsletter for info on Wrestling Mayhem Show and Indie Wrestling in general. And of course, the great Around the Indies column by one Matt Carlitz. Yes. That's been doing great on there, by the way.
It's fun.
Yeah.
My appreciation for independent wrestling grows by the week, because every time I put one of these things together, amazing.
We do an indie show, and you're still exposing me to new things on your column.
I can't believe some of the crap I dig up. And I tell you what, Halloween weekend in the indies,
oh no,
it gets crazy.
I didn't look at this one. Is it pretty nutty?
Buzz Lightyear was involved.
Oh no. Oh no. Go check that out. It looks like it's a lot of fun. IndieWrestling.us.
That was the timeline, and that was the time time limit in that match to infinity and beyond.
I'm not sure, but who's the tag team is to infinity and beyond. Who's the tag team right now? Colin Delaney and someone, right?
Oh, Colin Delaney and Cheech. Yeah.
Yep.
Oh, okay.
Things I learn. Independent wrestling, it goes on forever. You just keep consuming more stuff. There's always more to consume.
It's the never-ending smorgasbord of wrestling amazement.
It is.
All right. Speaking of wrestling amazement, we saw, and I know I one of you guys, I think I saw probably Garza commenting about, I feel like this was one of your comments I saw on Facebook over the last day, about why it came out. There's lightning. There's fire. Haven't we been wanting that forever? Some of us old heads, at least in the wrestling watching biz. And we got that with Wyatt. He ate the souls of Undertaker and Kane. They were drug off. I think we can make up in our minds a vision of them just being strung up in a swamp shack somewhere, like that weird season of Dexter, and it just being like sapped of their energy. I don't know how you want to imagine that part happening, but the Bray Wyatt has established himself, and talk about how he's surrounded himself by monsters, and I think this is really fun, and I know it's probably cheesy to a lot of people, and I'm kind of like curious about where the place is with wrestling as it is now. But you know, a lot of us, again, grew up with Papa Shango, Undertaker, that kind of concept, and kind of that was wrestling, right? That kind of side of things. Does it still work when it's not Undertaker?
Wait, that's the key question, isn't it? Because really, who's the only who other than the Undertaker has made this kind of stuff work?
Right.
Mel Muertes.
That's a conversation that I'm no doubt we're going to have later on in the show.
Well, and part of that, I think we will a little bit, but I think part of that, I watched Ultimate Lucha today in preparation, and just thinking about that again, like the end was like a guy that flies off and he's a dragon, and Mel Muertes and these other, you know, concepts in there, you know, these ideas that, you know, we created a world where this exists and it's okay because this is Lucha Underground here and this is how it works, right? Mm-hmm. Does WWE still exist in a world where we can say this is okay? Because I'm thinking like, okay, great, we have this thing happening and lightning and everything, and I'm thinking like I just have this image in the back of my head of like John Cena and Kevin Owens and all the, like, you know, fighting guys back there being like, I don't know, man. You know,
well,
like
Eamon.
Yep.
Sorry, but not even that. But we also, I think we had a discussion about this a few weeks ago on the Mayhem Show about how we're getting into this era now where it's more about reality and it's more about, you know, showing people inside looks at things and seeing these people more as people and stuff like that. So I think that's the reason it may not translate and may not work necessarily nowadays. Not because of, you know, necessarily, like, you know, the way, like, characters, you know, or anything like that. Just because the way how the companies work, we're seeing more, like, shoot interview type stuff now. We're seeing more realistic kind of stuff. So when they dive into that world of, like, mystic whatever, like, it's a little harder to believe, you know what I mean? I mean, maybe for, like, a younger audience, but, you know.
You just have to do the legwork on it. Like, if you do the like, when we see the demon Finn Balor come out,
right,
we say that's a different guy because he's explained it like, oh, this is me, Finn Balor, like I'm just a normal dude, but sometimes I have to let the demon out and it takes over control. Like, that's something that they do, and as weird as it is, because it wasn't the best story, but Hornswoggle living under the ring, and under the ring there was a giant little person's court.
No, but that was the a lot of times that was the rantings and ravings of JBL.
Yeah, but I mean, if you do the legwork, if you make us buy it, we'll eat it up.
Mm-hmm.
Like the problem that they've had with Bray Wyatt is that they've done the setup. They never did any punchline with it. You know, like they had him do all the spooky mysticism, all the really cool, creepy videos that we love. And then when he got to the ring or got to a feud, nothing. Like when he kidnapped Kane the first time, nothing happened after that. If you're going to do all that legwork, you need to have it have a resolution or a conclusion. He doesn't have to win, but you need to have it affect something.
I think also, and this is like weird, like a weird side part of it. Like if you want to look at, I think the two like biggest supernatural beings ever in the WWE, it's Undertaker and Kane. And it was established that Undertaker like has the lightning. Like Undertaker has lightning powers pretty much, and he can like, you know, control the lights and stuff like that.
This is where I get it to. I'm sorry.
And that's narrow to what he can do. Kane, on the other hand, controls fire.
Yeah.
Like they haven't narrowed down what Bray Wyatt is able to do. Like he's a shapeshifter, and then he's also like he can apparently consume people's souls now or something. Like they aren't narrowing, and then or he's just like a regular, just a guy who like is a cult. But like, they haven't like established kind of like what Mike said. Like, does he have powers? Does he, you know?
I think they have because he's always been able to teleport to the ring. He had his magic lamp to bring little kids.
His magic lamp. Wait. I just crossed over Bray Wyatt in my head with Aladdin. So that's happening now.
Yeah. But also, like, even that one Hell in the Cell where there was just, like, the lantern that had smoke or stuff like that that produced a hologram. That wasn't even explained.
My also detachment is, like, and this is not a problem. Like, I accept this for Lucha Underground, and I accept this in an Undertaker match. But we're talking about these people that are a freaking dragon or a dead man that controls lightning or fire or whatever, and then they just go in and have a wrestling match. You know what I mean? Like they're just like, we just put that the bit aside, and we're just like, and then we just go wrestle, you know? And I think that's always kind of an interesting kind of, well, it's okay, you know, kind of side of things.
I think that might be a product of you not finishing the entirety of Lucha Season 1. Because Mil Muertes, when he got destroyed in Grave Consequences, after he came back, he was a different character.
You know what?
Like he went from being a dominating Brock Lesnar kind of guy to 90s Undertaker that almost literally cannot be hurt.
Right. And I'm with you on that. And you know what I also love? The way you just explained why I was wrong because I didn't watch the entire thing is like the person that read the entirety of the X-Men comics and just explained to me a character development I never would have picked up on. which is great because you're completely I love that you're completely comic book nerd over Lucha Underground. That's a compliment. That is a compliment. So I want to point that out.
Have you ever read my fucking live tweets of Lucha Underground?
I have. I have.
Drago is Batman. Aerostar is Iron Man. We got Mario the Moth as fucking Killer Moth from the Batman universe, and he still doesn't know how moth wings work. Like.
And I want to point out that's why I have you guys collected tonight because even though I was not able to get to all the episodes of Lucha Underground, I lived vicariously the entire season through you guys on Midweek War, and that's why I think it's so amazing. And it is that different level, and it's this different stuff happening, and it's accomplishing. I don't even know what's accomplished. I was gonna say it accomplishes what Undertaker Papa Shango did back in the early 90s. But it is a bit more than that, isn't it? And it is something quite different. So,
to me, Papa Shango is kind of more like Bray Wyatt than The Undertaker is. Because I don't remember Papa Shango ever really accomplishing anything.
Why? There was the thing where he made black stuff come out of Undertaker or Ultimate Warrior's hair. That's all I remember.
And then he got the shit kicked out of him.
Oh, and then he made him throw up. You know? Yeah, I don't care if he got beat up. He made a guy throw up. I think that's significant, right? Like, how's he gonna beat him? You know, I mean, that's like the goofy pinfall in a tag team match today, making Ultimate Warrior throw up. That gives you a little bit of build, right? So, what's up, Matt?
But to Mad Mike's point, okay, Papa Shango can make ooze come out of your forehead. He can make you throw up. But if you can get into a match with Papa Shango, all he can do is punch and kick you.
Because he's got the voodoo. Yeah, well, okay, gotta
make
goes,
it work in the ring,
Sorg.
But that
goes back to the why does the dragon guy just wrestle, you know? I'm not trying to tear apart these concepts, but really, just like that, I'm just kind of taking all sides of it.
Sorg, Drago spits mist.
Okay, you got me there.
Yeah, he has a dragon mist.
You got me there, yeah.
And he doesn't necessarily even breathe fire, though, like, is the thing.
No, like, no, he just, like, he's like the human torch, kind of.
Pretty much, yeah.
But maybe season two. We'll see.
Season two, you don't know what's going to happen. But anyways, so, jeez.
One more point, since we were talking about The Undertaker and Kane. And when I think about how the way Kane was introduced and when in the history of professional wrestling Kane was introduced, Kane's character got in just under the wire for when we all flipped over to the Attitude Era and we kind of left it all behind. But because Kane got in while we were still kind of accepting all the still cartoony, comic booky kind of characters, Kane got in and we just brought Kane along for the ride. That's so right. While everything during the Attitude Era became more real, you know, more grounded, more realistic, Kane and the Undertaker remained batshit crazy, should never have worked. If you plopped Kane in and tried to introduce him in the year 2001,
right.
People would have been like, he's Mordecai, you know? He doesn't work. You know what I'm saying?
Poor Mordecai. Wait, we did have a vampire. We did have a vampire in ECW, but then again, we also had a zombie.
And those didn't work either.
No. Thank you, sci-fi. Thank you. Although Kevin Thorne was cool. Like that, even cooler was, what's her name? That
Ariel.
Well, think about it. We had a vampire in that era, and we technically had a vampire in the Attitude Era.
That's true.
And look at how, you know, they were portrayed, and look at the differences between what they could and couldn't do.
But the difference is, Gangrel was trading off the Lost Boys, which was at least kind of culturally relevant when Gangrel started. I think they tried to play off Kevin Thorne as a Twilight vampire, but A, it was lame, and two, it was about 3 years too late.
I think the thing about Gangrel, too, was that, like, so much about Gangrel was left unsaid. It was just like, well, here's this dude, and he's got fangs, and he spits this stuff in his cup out, but I don't know, he's got Christian with him. I don't know what's going on. And then, so they're never really saying, like, you know, dude, he's a vampire.
Is that Eamon?
I was just sorry. I just was gonna say there was a period when they had to like dance around stuff. Like I believe they couldn't even directly call him a vampire. They just had to call him somebody with what was the phrase they used? Like he follows.
He's living like a gothic lifestyle or something like that. But I mean, I think the character was better for it.
And they couldn't ever say blood. They could just say that he drinks blood, but that he drinks a red viscous liquid.
Wait, they really said that back then?
This was also in the era before Hot Topic sold Captain America shirts. So people didn't really know what that was all about.
Yeah.
Man. When
Hot Topic went soft, like, Sorg, you remember that.
I remember that. I remember how hard.
Now even I can go in there.
Yeah. Like that was my day. Like, when you buy the pants that were way too big for you with the reflectors on it for some reason. And and also like the Marilyn Manson and anything where I'm pretty sure I couldn't hear words.
I had a lot of Slipknot
and Lamb of God, like that kind of thing. What is this podcast becoming? What's going on here?
It's funny also in that era how, like, I mean, it was the Attitude Era, but there's also stuff they had to dance around, like stuff like that. I think there was also, wasn't there a time when, like, they had to, like, stores had to recall, like, an Al Snow doll because parents were complaining that it came with a severed head?
Yeah,
that was great.
Right. That's right.
That was great.
Like it's interesting to see. And nowadays, none of that can happen. You know what I mean? Like they wouldn't be able to get away with anything nowadays.
Well, to be fair, I'm pretty sure they could still market the Al Snow's mannequin head. I'm pretty sure that would still be okay.
Yeah.
Wow. Anyways, on that note, let's you know what else is full of mysticism and magic, Mad Mike?
Slice on Broadway,
supporting Pittsburgh podcasting with the perfect pepperoni pizza. Thank you so much There's nothing mysterious about these good eats. Check them out in the South Hills here in Beachview, right along the tracks here, as well as on Main Street in Carnegie, PA. And you can check them out. Say hi to Rico down there. And what do you got there?
I just want to show everybody
is there anything left in there? I don't know. You're like the third guest down here. There it is. And that's just a pepperoni pizza, and it's damn good too. It's just a pepperoni pizza, but it's a little washed out there. But
I don't know how TV works.
No, you don't. We don't have HD monitors behind us or anything for you to do things with, right? I don't know what to do with
yourself. I have to slum it here in the Sorgatron Studios.
I got this like LCD, standard LCD back here. Does that work for you? Can we put a cityscape of Pittsburgh back here?
I'm sorry, sir. Your monitor is obsolete.
It's obsolete. At least it's not a CRT. those are off camera. But anyways... What was I getting at? Oh, you should go to Slice on Broadway or say hi to them at sliceonbroadway.com. Look up Slice on Broadway on the Facebook, on the Instagrams, and say hi to them on PGH_Slice and tell them you heard about them on the Wrestling Mayhem Show. Now let's take a look back at all that crazy stuff we did last week around these parts at sorgatronmedia.com. We'll be right back.
A lot of noises, but no language. He liked to bash his head off a thing. Bricks, mainly. He would throw bricks up in the air and then jump and smash the brick. He was a interesting fella, Rambo was.
Chachi is not here, by the way.
Senor Maple Leaf.
Yes, he
is. Olay! It's Halloween. I'm allowed to do this.
Happy Halloween.
I am allowed to do this. I'm sorry, it's really hot under there.
If you've noticed, we have the travelwits.com, which solves the cheapest way to get from A to B, vacations within budget. And one of the problems that seems interesting to us down the road is utilization of hotel points and mile frequent flyer miles.
The Google Trends Freightgeist? Whoa!
Yeah, so this will tell you what the trending search Halloween costumes search trends are there. If you look at the top above the map, there's a trending nationally.
Zima says it all the time. Be humble. Just be humble, listen. And Zima's one of those guys where I feel like I probably wouldn't be where I am in wrestling if it wasn't for things he said and advice he gave me.
I like to think that Brock Lesnar and Undertaker just have baby fingernails that are like razor sharp. And they just couldn't help it, you know?
We're back, Wrestling Mayhem Show. Please check out Sawtooth Willie. This week, he gets horny. You'll see what that means. Go look up Sawtooth Willie, our favorite Pittsburgh hobo, and the Boxcar Beautician on the YouTube and the Facebook, so you don't miss a video there. Scott Steiner. Yes, that's Scott Steiner. You have it handy over there?
Yep, I got it right
here. That Scott Steiner makes an appearance, and I don't know. Something weird happens with that.
Does he do math?
Your arms. My arms are bigger than your leg.
Yeah. So, Matt Carlins, you have a big question of the week for us.
Well, it's a dirty job, but somebody's got to do it, Sorg. So I figured since we've been talking about Lucha Underground, it's timely because, production is just underway on season 2 of Lucha Underground out somewhere in Boyle Heights in a warehouse somewhere. It's so awesome. I'm so excited. And we talk all about how Lucha Underground has created this altered reality. It's so unique from the rest of professional wrestling. And I know that deep down in the back of our brains, we all have a current wrestler out there that we secretly wish would just show up on Lucha Underground someday. So, the big question for this week is, which current wrestler would you pluck from their current situation and place into Lucha Underground?
Ooh.
Shit.
Ooh.
That's good.
I need to think about it, Sorg. You go ahead.
Now, who would you pluck out? Like, are we like kind of like we don't like the situation they're in with WWE? Think they would just generally benefit?
Or no,
just
this is basically only for our benefit. We want them in Lucha because that would be better for us as the viewer, That's basically all. Right.
Kevin Owens. Kevin Owens. I think,
really?
I think Kevin Owens. I think he'd be ridiculous there. Like, not that he would be like a crazy like lucha character or anything like that. He'd just be like a badass amongst gods.
I would like to see the backstage vignettes with Kevin Owens.
Yeah.
I would probably get down with the Kevin Owens and Dario Cueto's office. Would probably be fun.
Not that I could be wrong, but I'm pretty sure Lucha Underground, not a lot of Canadian representation there.
No.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but I don't think there is. I don't know, unless they're under masks. But
I don't believe so, no.
Although, secondary answer, I'd love to see El Generico show up. Why the hell not, right? But, you know, he'd be kind of like that goofy character that gets thrown into, like, the four ways and everything that seemed to be, like, the mid-card there, like with Jack Evans. So, but, I don't know, that's my take. Mike, you said you had one?
I had one, but I'd be an asshole saying it. I was going to say Alberto Del Rio. No, my real answer, though, Delirious.
Oh.
Give me Delirious negotiating his contract with Dario Cueto.
Please. Oh, jeez, yes.
Please.
Oh, jeez, yes.
He never has to show up in the ring. I just want a backstage segment with Delirious and Dario Cueto negotiating their deal.
What?
And Dario, pretending like he understands everything Delirious says, signs the contract, and as soon as he walks away, he turns to Black Lotus and like, what the hell was that guy talking about?
So it's kind of like those, because they have those very bilingual conversations in this show, right? So, mm-hmm. So he doesn't get subtitled?
No. Okay. Absolutely not. Have you ever seen the video with Delirious and Chris Jericho?
Yes.
That, but picture Jericho as a heel instead of being buddy.
Okay. I got you. A secondary thought. I don't know, but Delirious as backstage interviewer, and I'll leave you with that.
Okay, I'm acceptable with that too. Also,
she can replace Devin in NXT, or he.
Also,
he,
I would love.
Can
to
we
see,
get a female Delirious while we're at it?
I would love to see.
Just maybe think about Devin Taylor and Lucha.
I want to see the Colony go for the Trios Championship.
Ooh, that'd be nice. All right. Who else got one?
I came up with mine. Okay. I got mine. And stay with me here when I say this. I'm trying to think of somebody that would attribute both in-ring as well as like the backstage, like movie-style vignettes and stuff like that. And the one that immediately came to my mind was Chad Gable.
Oh yeah, that'd be good.
I really love the idea of them, this being a lucha libre generally environment, having an Olympic like mat wrestler come in, and you can do a lot with that, but also he's got the wrestling combined with his, you know, just personality. I feel like that would be a perfect just fit in. I feel like he could fit in anywhere. That would be a perfect fit in on Lucha.
Eamon, I feel like him in the backstage segments of Lucha, you'd be like Fred on the Scooby-Doo gang.
Yes, absolutely.
Like the straight man with an ascot. That would be Chad Gable in the Lucha Underground locker room.
But yeah, that would be mine. I would really enjoy that.
Who are we missing? Garza, did you get one yet?
No. I was actually going to say also the Colony, but Matt Mike with his fans. So I'm going to go, I guess, since we were talking about him, Kevin Thorne and Ariel as actual vampires.
Yeah,
I'm with that. Absolutely. All right. Who else? Did everybody get theirs in? I don't know if we have anything.
Forget about me, Sorg. Here.
You didn't get one. Okay.
The chat room real quick. I'm going to tell you guys. I got a lot of good candidates in my mind. I would like to see Ethan Carter III try Lucha Underground, just because he could kind of be like Del Rio, except American. So, and richer.
Just
so,
like American a-hole.
American a-hole, rich.
Yeah.
EC3 would probably work great.
I hope. Are you listening to Joseph? Are you taking notes, man?
Yeah, that's good. Another guy.
Bobby in the chat room says Shinsuke Nakamura.
That would be a great one, too.
Obviously.
Yes.
That's all.
Guy who could do anything. You know who? Guy who's been tearing it up with Ricochet lately. Who bears a striking resemblance to Prince Puma, by the way. But a guy who's been tearing it up with Ricochet, Matt Sydal, at least in the ring, could be spectacular in Lucha Underground. And
he could, you know, because he's like for real that kind of like the you hear the Colt Cabana one where he's talking about when he took peyote that one time, like like that's him. Like I think you know who gets higher than RVD? Probably Matt Sydal.
Probably Matt Sydal. Yeah, that's actually a good
point. You know, I wasn't even really thinking Ring of Honor. The Briscoes would be amazing in Lucha.
They would be giants too.
Jeez, they would. They would.
The Briscoes would. Oh God, that would be fun.
I just love this idea of these like clashing just cultures in Lucha.
Like the Briscoes would be the only two-person tag team to go for the trios titles just because they truck three people at once.
Eamon, are you seeing what's happening in the chat room for some recommendations from Cars?
I am not. Please let me know.
He's saying, and I want your reaction here, he's saying Archibald Peck or Jervis Cottonbelly, and I think you worked with both.
I worked with neither, technically.
That's right.
Yeah. But no, I can see that. I mean,
for those who don't know, Chikara, guys.
I feel like Chikara, I mean, anyone from Chikara would really apply. Mm-hmm. Because it's been established that universe fits, you know, those level of characters. You know what I mean?
You guys don't feel like Chikara is too comedic for Lucha Underground? Not that Lucha Underground doesn't have its laughs.
Yeah, I think you would adapt the characters a little bit, right?
Yeah.
Go ahead, Garza.
No, I was going to say that more people have died in Chikara in the last years than in Lucha Underground. So, Chikara's a really, really dark place.
It's been a dark time. I don't know, man. I watched it in Ultimate Lucha. I'm just like, it's the era of death in Lucha Underground. You're telling me it gets more deadly than that?
All right. I have a follow-up to the big question, you guys.
Okay.
No, it just popped in my brain.
Is this a not-so-big question?
No, this is who would you absolutely never want to see in Lucha Underground?
Oh, that's a better question.
Oh, Randy Orton.
No, I think Orton would be fantastic if he was an actual snake.
You know what? Yeah.
Okay. All right.
I'm with Mad Mike on this. If I had to pick yes or no, I would say yes to Randy Orton in Lucha Underground.
So basically, anybody that's got a really cool WWE Immortals character, let them go. Is that what you're saying?
It would go from WrestleMania to WrestleMania the arcade game.
That's right.
Would I never take?
By the way, Dawn Castle was called out for somebody who should go.
Oh man, that would be pretty good.
The boys.
Only if he brought Los Niños.
Yes.
Oh jeez. Never take.
That's so hard.
That is hard
because I keep thinking of these ridiculous people. Like I'm going through like random names in my head, and I'm like Booker T. That would be no. It would probably work
Tyler Breeze probably.
Yeah, it would work.
Dana Brooke probably.
Hey, Dana Brooke works now, Sorg.
Yeah, I can't. Dana Brooke is the who's the last person where we're like this isn't gonna work, and we all just came around on that person, like Bo Dallas or somebody, right? By the way, Bo Dallas or Boo Dallas was amazing on Halloween, a special SmackDown this week. You should go watch the Halloween.
Bo Dallas. I'm not sure Bo Dallas would work.
You don't?
You don't think?
I'm just trying to be difficult at this point. We got to come up with something.
All right. You know who I would never want to see in Lucha? And it pains me to say this. John Cena.
Yeah.
Even though, like, he literally has the built-in gimmick of Juan Cena. Like, if he just threw on that Lucha mask and wore that singlet he had in Total Divas, that would be amazing. But I would never want to see him in Lucha Underground.
Juan Cena versus Matt Classic could be a thing then. I pay minimal amounts of money to see that.
The only person I can think of that I wouldn't want would probably maybe be Eva Marie, just not from a wrestling perspective even, but from like, I feel like she can't act. And I feel like you need a certain level of acting ability in an environment like Lucha Underground.
But to be fair, since this is very grindhouse, I feel like Like you,
if
can,
she was just like,
you can be Telemundo. Like, you know what I mean? Like you can be that level, and it's kind of okay. I think like also she's not like in front of a live crowd doing these things. Like these are performed scenes behind the scenes. She can be coached a little bit more. I think,
unlike some other companies, they actually edit.
True that. There's that. Highly edited probably product there. So I think that's where she would thrive on that side of things. And since I'm sorry, she's coming around on the wrestling and they could probably do some interesting things there. To be honest, I don't think they'd even put her in a ring. I think she'd just be like, like
Katrina.
Yeah. Like Katrina and stuff. You know, I think that's what she'd just end up being that in that environment. Like, cause
She'll just have to re-dye her hair and be Black Lotus when Black Lotus like starts wrestling.
There you go. But no, I think just with when they put girls in the ring, they're good, right? Like they're pretty damn good when they're at Lucha. So
and it's so hard to say who you wouldn't want there because you like with Lucha, you always feel like there could be an upside. You know what I mean?
Because
it's such a different environment.
Well, look at Del Rio and Patron. You know, I thought Del Rio was always super flat in WWE to me.
Mm-hmm.
Like, there was very few instances where he was over with me as a heel, as a face, anything. Except for, like, I thought Rodriguez was more over than him. And then he came in and was like, oh, this is going to be cool. You know, and it was. And him with Johnny Mundo and everything was just tremendous.
Can you see Johnny Mundo again for me?
And now he's in a visibly uncomfortable situation in WWE.
And he's already wrestled R-Truth twice.
Yeah, it's just like he's already just shuffled to the mid-card on this weird thing. And like we even had like the Jack Swagger, what the hell are you doing segment on Raw. That wasn't like on Superstars or something where I thought it probably belonged. But it happened, you know? And I don't know. I don't know if I can take it. I like Swagger. I like Del Rio, but I don't think I can take another Del Rio Swagger feud again. You know, like Swagger needs that Cesaro team up thing to happen again for him to get anywhere.
And right it now. Would work because Cesaro is an immigrant, and they hate immigrants right? that aren't from Mexico or America,
which is really odd.
Yeah, I found that completely side note. I found that weird that like how Zeb said in his promo last night, he's like, I want to bind America and Mexico together, but not Canada.
Okay, like, okay. I gotta say, okay, all right, we're veering off from the big question, but let's go. I want to go into this conversation.
So he wasn't even trying to get heat.
All right, Eamon. Okay, so I don't know my opinion of this because, well, other than I have a lot of it's a very Mexican neighborhood up here, but I think we're a little close to the Canadian border, us and Mad Mike here, to really have an opinion. How is this getting over in Texas, you guys?
I don't know.
Where it's a little more of an issue, right? Or discussion.
It's just like you said before. It's so weird.
But is it something that like gets the Latino population into them? I don't know. I don't get what the discussion point is on this versus the old Zeb stuff.
I don't know how it would. It's just an old. It's just an older, formerly, pro-American everything, like dude with a beard, like on a scooter with just like Mexican flag stuff all over it.
And nobody's explained the scooter either.
Yeah, here's the thing: I think WWE and a lot of mainstream wrestling doesn't get about Mexico, maybe immigrants or people who are Mexican American or whatever. You can't just be like, oh, Mexico, and expect people to. Love you.
It doesn't work like Hacksaw Jim Duggan USA USA. You can't you don't chant Mexico and get the same thing.
This has to come from an authentic level, I feel. Like Eddie Guerrero was authentic. Like and he had a big following in South Texas because it wasn't because he was like, yeah, Mexico every time he was out. He didn't come out with Mexican flags and all this stuff. It was just because he was legitimately Mexican American and people can gravitate towards that and they see it's got to be natural.
And is there, and because we also mentioned something in the chat room after one comment I just made, but this is a very all-inclusive gimmick of the Mexican, the American, and also the handicapped. So
yeah.
it's like all the kids in the Burger King Club with the one in the wheelchair and everything, or Glee maybe, all in one package.
Burger King Club.
That's a, I'm sorry, that's a deep cut. There was a guy in a wheelchair named Wheels. And they're just like, there you go, you're included. And again, it was one of those, like, you know.
He was blonde with glasses, Sorg.
Holy moly.
Oh, that's a
deep
different
cut of the week. You win. Holy crap.
Really? We waxed philosophical about the Spice Girls for about 20 minutes? And that's,
spoilers!
Knowledge about the Burger King Club definitely trumps any boy or girl band.
Listen, I didn't have PBS, but I had the Burger King Kings Club in the kids' club in the town over.
Wait, that was a show?
No, it wasn't a show. It was just like, that was just one of the pleasures of my childhood, was getting a Happy Meal. Come on, man.
I'm like, so it's what I think it was. It was like a thing you sign up for and you get.
No. It was whatever. Just like you had Happy Meals and then you had the Burger King Kids Club because they didn't have Ronald McDonald. So they're trying to do their little mascot thing. Why the hell are we talking about this on a wrestling show?
Because it was before Eamon's time. We have to explain what life
Lucha
was
Underground,
like.
Lucha Underground is our Burger King Kids Club.
Not everyone
gets El Rey. So if you know about it, you feel included.
Don't you ever compare Burger King to Lucha Underground again.
I brought the whole thing around.
Burger King is to Lucha El Rey, or Lucha, oh geez, I don't even know anymore, as McDonald's is to WWE. It's the thing that's not the top thing, but it tastes better and it's flame broiled. Okay, I got an email here.
I can't believe we're gonna compare fast food restaurants to wrestling promotions, and you're not gonna pick the most obvious one to compare to Lucha Underground.
Which one? Oh, we'll just leave you all with that. Is everybody okay out there, Garza? You look like, I don't, are you okay? It looks like you're about to explode over there.
It's all good. It's all good.
That may be the most accurate thing Sork has ever said on this show.
I apologize. Wheels did not have glasses.
Okay. All right. Well, let's see. I got that covered. Speaking of the left coast, Alex Carr sent an email, and it's weird.
The left coast?
Left coast.
The left.
The left coast. Like, not the, like, left-leaning politically. Like, they're the one on the left on the map.
Although they do.
Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
We
although
call
they
it
do.
West Sorg.
The left? What? I'm trying to be clever, damn it. Alex Carrs writes, hey, Wrestling Mayhem Shonaverse. It's Alex Carrs back from a recent stint of rehab after to get over my addiction to terrible wrestling booking to check with you guys on a topic that's been talked about almost to the point of exhaustion, John Cena and his refusal to turn heel for various reasons. I don't think John Cena has a say in the matter, to be quite honest. I'm pretty sure that's other people that get the t-shirt numbers. You know what I mean?
I would like to think that if John Cena wanted to turn heel bad enough, he could make that happen.
The last time they did that was Austin, and it didn't really work out.
Yeah, exactly, but true. It proved the point that even the most once you're the most popular star in the company, you get whatever you want, no matter how stupid it is. So,
like you get your girlfriend to take the same amount of time off as you.
Yeah.
Okay. Anyways, so. Blah, 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 blah. I wanted to get to the nitty gritty on this, and so I'd like to hear from you. Is it possible for John Cena to turn heel without it affecting merchandise sales, Make-A-Wish, etc.? So he gets into this about the Make-A-Wish and everything. He thinks it's possible because we have a situation where wrestlers from WWE publicly support causes regardless of whether they're a face or a heel. We recently saw The Miz at a Be A Star event. He's always at those things. He's always at those kinds of events. He's always at media representation. I mean, we've all seen that, right, guys? Lost my place. There we go. If he can do that, nearly every heel can wear a Rise Above Cancer shirt. Although weird ones, you know, I also point out they do have some that kind of skip that, like say Bray Wyatt. I think that would be weird to see like pink Wyatt family get-ups. But anyways, I think the face of the company can do Make-A-Wish and all that as a heel. I'm not entirely sure how they pull it off. Hence the reason I'm asking you. And he has some other stuff about Chikara. So real quick, he's doing a Chikara 15 minutes or less. And the fifth episode, since relaunch, will be up by the time you read this. It's up now. Go get it. And my screensaver kicked in, and I lost the email. Sorry, I really love that Apple TV screensaver. I put it on 2 minutes, and it's just not enough time for a podcast.
Read faster.
But anyways, go to the main hub at chikara15.com. There is your plug, sir. Thank you very much. And so powerthesmarts.com. So anyways, so what do you think?
Go ahead. I was just going to say, to one of his points about the Make-A-Wish stuff, like, I feel like a heel can do Make-A-Wish. They just, the only thing is that WWE couldn't, like, promote it on their television show, you know what I mean? At least in, like, in the way John Cena does. They can't, like, publicly on their on Raw or something like that be like, hey, you know, this person that you're supposed to hate or whatever and does horrible things, he's got, like, a great record of doing Make-A-Wish or whatever, you know? Like, that's the only thing they couldn't do. Like, you know what I mean?
Because that's what they do with Brie Bella, Nikki Bella, and Triple H and Hunter all the time. They're supposed to be like the super heels, but then they always show them doing like the Susan G. Coleman thing and all that stuff. So
yeah,
I think it's terrible storytelling, but they do it.
Right. I mean, it's a little bit of, I'm trying to find a good example. I mean. I know wrestling's in this weird spot where it's like, okay, what's the real thing? What's the disbelief thing? And then it's like, you know, versus I'm watching a show and who am I thinking? Okay, the Spike of back. I don't know why I'm thinking Spike from Buffy the Vampire Slayer is the first thing that comes to my head. But like they're doing something.
He was a heel, right?
Yeah, he was a heel. He was a heel for a bit, and then he kind of came around to a face, and there was a love story, and it's weird. But it's like seeing a spot work. Hey, here are the stars of Smallville, and here's Michael Rosenbaum doing Make a Wish and stuff, you know, or something like around that, or doing a commercial, or doing an out of character soundbite. Hey, you're watching CW. I'm Mike Rosenbaum, Lex Luthor, you know. John Cena is the difference, right? Roddy Piper is Roddy Piper, even though that's not even his name, but he's still Roddy Piper outside, regardless. Like we don't separate, but there's a history of not separating. There wasn't a point where we thought the actors on our screens were actually the characters when we meet them. I know some people, if you go to a Comic-Con, they don't know the difference, but general knowledge, that wasn't the case. Versus we thought Roddy Piper was Roddy Piper everywhere until about the 90s, right?
It also depends on when you see these people in person, because sometimes they will act exactly like their character.
But also, they were supposed to, right?
Yeah.
Up until a certain point.
For the most part. I mean, I went to a signing once with William Regal and Eugene, and Eugene was having very normal conversations with everyone. Right. So, you know, there's a give and take, but... Am I the only one who thinks John Cena would sell more merch as a heel?
Because all the guys would get it. Just like everybody's buying. How many indie shows?
Kevin Owens?
Every show you've been to, indie, WWE, ROH, whatever. You know how many KO shirts I see?
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
I think
there was a time when Cena had some sweet merch. So
that's right.
But they're capitalizing off Cena hate already. They're selling. Or I don't know if they're still selling them, but I know they were selling like Cena sucks shirts at one point in time. Mm-hmm. Like they're able to capitalize off of the hatred for John Cena, even when he's technically a face. Like,
yeah. And then you just flip it when he goes heel. And Cars is saying in the chat room, actually, see, I think Cena joining the Authority is the way around the whole thing, but it seems weird.
John Cena as a heel would basically be the Authority.
I think if they did it...
He would still be doing the Make-A-Wish stuff and the Coleman stuff in the middle of the shows, and then all the rest of the time. So he's doing the right thing, you know, as the company man, but then during the rest of the show, he's just a jerk.
Yeah, and I don't think he'd need to do something like Stone Cold beating Lita with a chair or something like that, right? Because the problem was, Stone Cold was already the bad guy. We just cheered for him, so it was awkward when he became the bad guy towards the wrong people. Right? Versus John Cena could actually do bad things. I know, Mike, you're going to say, but he already does kind of asshole things to begin with. But...
But like Sorg said, he does it to the right people.
It's more alignment than your actions.
Is it, though?
Hulk Hogan's an ass. I'm with CM Punk. Hogan was the heel that.
See, the thing is, Hulk Hogan would always come out to save his friends.
Oh, no, he wouldn't.
Oh, yes, he would.
Only when a hot piece of ass like Elizabeth was pulling him out.
For whatever reason, he would run out.
Right.
John Cena never runs out.
That's true. John Cena looks out for John Cena. But
well, I mean, if we're going to go in that case, look, the Undertaker was kidnapped 2 weeks ago. How many guys have gone looking for him on Raw?
And dead men and Samoans Nobody. Get no love when they get kidnapped.
No one's looking for him. Bunch of jerks, all of them.
Well, Kane went looking for him.
That's true.
And you saw how that happened, how that worked out.
And I got to point out, Lucha Underground, kidnappings have a heavier weight to them. Somebody actually looks for them.
And Sorg, people get fucking killed.
There's a heavier weight to them. Something people happens.
People get killed, and the announcers don't even find out about it. Like, that's how, you know, on the down low that shit is. I still think Matt Stryker expects Bale to show up and wrestle in season two.
I'm afraid if I ever met Matt Stryker, that if I told him what happened to Bale, he would be stunned.
He would just break down and cry.
I just like thought he was on break.
I just thought it's been a while.
I thought it was just a paid leave. I thought Dario gave him a vacation.
Oh jeez.
Yeah. I thought he got booked in Japan. I didn't know.
I thought I saw him on Paragon Pro Wrestling. No, that wasn't him.
How do you kill off somebody? Yeah, it gets awkward. It gets awkward. And they just open another company. I mean, that's like a whole storyline hole right there waiting to happen. Be like, I don't know.
I wish they killed off Hernandez and they just randomly showed back up on TNA.
Wouldn't that make like TNA like the afterlife fed? Like everyone just kind of like passes on to that?
It would make TNA housing patient zero and the zombie apocalypse would start in the impact zone.
Wow, that got, I was just going to say it's purgatory, but that got really complicated, so.
Wow, purgatory wrestling, that'd be wild. We should tell Chris about that.
That explains why it seems like time never passes in TNA.
It's just like purgatory wrestling would be all the people with the 90-day no compete clauses, like wrestling like in a secret location, and they just release all it. They just release all the tapes after the 90-day clause, and it's purgatory wrestling. Is that too complicated?
That sounds perfect.
Or did I just describe TNA?
You kind of did.
Actually, think about it. It is kind of TNA these days.
It is kind of TNA because everything is filmed from at least 90 days ago now.
I'm so sorry, Garza. I forgot that you're the supporter. Okay. I know. It's so easy. They're gonna have shows in New York City at the beginning of the year. Or was that a joke thing too, like the shutdown that I read? But that's happening. And they did good in New York, so. Oh boy.
What a night.
Heard Zima had a good match last week. So I promoted, at least. So that's good.
There's still thunder.
What's that?
At least there's no thunder and fire and lightning.
No, because the place would burn down because they don't have the budget to make sure they do it right.
TNA keeps it real, Sorg.
TNA tried pyro once. They ended up burning down half the impact zone and had to start the pay-per-view late.
Oh, that did happen. They had to hold it mid pay-per-view, didn't they?
Uh-huh.
Something like that. It was crazy. I remember the impact zone in Orlando.
At one of the pay-per-views this year, they tried doing the, oh no, we're wrestling back in the electrical equipment spot, and they actually blew the fucking electrical equipment.
No.
TNA can't do that.
Reality error, man.
You're getting a little too real. Yeah. Oh man, they're taking Triple H a little too literal. All right, on that note. I think we learned a lot from this show.
This has been your edition of the Midweek War.
Maybe the most educational mayhem show I've heard in a long time, Sorg. We're not just laying it out about wrestling. We're learning about Burger King Kids Club.
This is a lead-in.
We're dropping Buffy knowledge. Did we talk about Hot Topic on the show, or were we on the air when we did?
You know, there's that show. There's that show where the Attitude Era one that Eamon likes, where isn't the one guy watches it and then he describes it to the other person? Or is this a different show? Or no, they both watch it, don't they? But there was one where somebody describes things that happened because he didn't watch wrestling for like 10 years. And he described things.
That's How to Wrestling.
How to Wrestling, right? So we're going to do the same thing with Eamon. But instead, we're just going to explain concepts in our childhood that we experienced and just explain it to him and our perceptions of that. And Sorg, just, yeah.
Sorg, that actually could be a really good podcast.
I think it would be an awesome podcast.
It would be really a lot.
It would be cross-generational and just be like, let's just explain to the youngin, and you're like, what, like 12 years younger than me or something like that? So that's like,
probably. Sorg,
that's
Sorg,
significant. That's Sorg, like,
we can call it I Lived the 90s.
That's right. That's right.
And all I had the 90s versus most of the 90s as well.
Lived the 90s, drooled the 90s. Mm-hmm. There you go.
Todd lived the 90s.
It's like Garza.
The 90s.
He could have the second part. It would be explaining what's EDM and dubstep to us.
Ah, yes! Yes! Eamon can explain things from 2015. Like, Eamon, what does on fleek mean?
You're in college. You know what the cool stuff is. Come on. We'll have my... Hey, you know what? Actually, my nephew's like just getting into college, so we'll just like have both of you on. So, although
I am not a good perspective on what the youths nowadays are all about.
The youths? But. Did you just say the youths?
I meant to say the youths with an H. But
all right, this is deteriorating fast. What did you guys learn from wrestling this week?
I wish I learned.
I love. By the way, this is the second or third time. Matt, like, because I can't see him from over this monitor because I have poor ergonomics
feng shui.
Feng shui in this studio. So he just raises his hand over the monitor so he knows he has something to say.
Well, I get tired of power talking over our other guests, Sorg.
I know.
But I think we did all right this week. Well, you know, I posted this on the Facebook group, but I'm still not over it. What I learned from wrestling this week, I learned that Taz hates orange and black.
I saw that. That just destroyed your world.
Right in the childhood. I can't.
And he responded to that too, didn't he?
He did. He told me everything's a work. I said, what?
It's a work, brother.
And he didn't respond to my... I responded by saying, are you trying to tell me that you're not sitting there doing your radio show with a ratted up, torn up towel over your head? He didn't answer me. I think he didn't want to break my heart again.
He's like, I'm worried about this one. Wow. What about you, Mad Mike?
Oh God. I learned this from Breaking Ground. Dana Brooke puts in more effort than ZZ. I don't think that's something that is a surprise to anyone, but just hearing Dana Brooke talk about her everyday workout routine and then seeing ZZ's, let's stop giving Dana Brooke shit, you guys.
Yeah.
Let's stop it.
I don't think we ever discount her like fitness level, right? But you're saying it's like beyond, I didn't watch the episode yet. You're saying it's like even beyond God. What we thought.
Dude, ZZ, like, I'm pretty sure I work out harder than ZZ.
I believe Dana Brooks could kill ZZ.
Like, I'm fairly confident I have better cardio than ZZ. Fairly confident about it.
I don't know if we're going to fully discuss, I don't know if we're ever going to, like, on another show where I fully discuss Breaking Ground. But can we briefly talk about ZZ's dad? For those that watched it.
Oh, you mean Ted Nugent?
Oh my God.
Ted Nugent. By the way, Eamon, you don't know who Ted Nugent is? Look him up on the Goog. You'll find it. It's like.
Do you invent a new word?
No. That's what we've been saying on AwesomeCast the last 2 weeks.
Oh my goodness. Tremendous.
ZZ's dad looks like if Mrs. Dad never left Walmart.
I've never seen them doing the same place
Walmart,
at the same time,
just
store.
The hunting section.
Remember, he was there, like, coaching ZZ when, like, he should have been listening to Robbie Brookside or whatever, and his dad's just, like, giving him advice or whatever. Like, what? Oh.
Robbie Brookside's telling you to get on the treadmill. Don't talk to your dad.
Oh, no.
My goodness. Yeah. ZZ's dad was a trip.
Oh, and one other thing I learned from wrestling this week. If you do a forward roll, just step forward. Step forward with your fucking left foot.
Get it right.
I'm sorry, Eamon.
Or Regal will we'll make a point to say something to you.
That wait, was okay. I don't know.
What? Wait. Explain that. Eamon, since he stole yours, explain to me what the hell he's talking about.
Okay, so they have a segment in Breaking Ground where they're training or they're working with the tryout people, and they're basically just doing roles. And Regal starts, you know, instructing some people, when you do a forward roll, you don't jump. Like some of them when they come up, they would jump or whatever and do their fighting stance. You just step forward with your left foot. And everyone kept messing it up, and everyone kept not listening, and Regal was not having it. And seeing scenes like that, like, I don't know about you guys, but it gives me the most like awkward feeling. Like it's the worst awkwardness ever. But yeah, I'd never want to get yelled at by women.
But that's people, like, but that's wrestling training. That is wrestling training. If you're ever like happen to be witnessing a class, there's always like that point where it's just like, oh, it is bad. I guess we've all, if you've been in sports practice, I think that happens too, right? I remember that day in wrestling, in basketball, you know, in bowling, you know, I mean, that's, you know,
I was waiting for William Regal to say, is Bill Regal going to have to choke a motherfucker? Right
here? I don't understand how anybody in that tryout could have gotten that wrong more than one time after Regal told them how to do it. I'm watching it on TV. Sorg, I will never bounce after falling over again, after rolling again. I will always step with my left foot. All I had to do was see Regal on TV one time yell at somebody. I'm like, I got it. I'm good, Regal.
Hey, you know, sometimes you get things instilled. You know, one time I saved myself from being hurt really, really bad falling down a flight of stairs. Because I landed flat on my back, because I knew to do that from the little bit of wrestling training I've had. It's
Sorg.
Yeah.
When I fell off a ladder, I took a back bump, and I only messed up my ankle because JR always asks, "How do you learn to fall off a 20-foot ladder?" you watch a lot of fucking wrestling, man. That's how you learn. That's how you goddamn learn.
Just imagine like what that scenario would have been like if Bill DeMott was still the head trainer.
Oh, I'd rather not.
Yeah, that's the real reason. They let him go because they're like, yeah, we can't put him on TV talking like that. That's we just
look like the nice friendly guy.
All right, who hasn't gone yet? Garza,
we don't need Morris. We need the hip hop hippo, you guys.
Garza, what'd you learn this week?
I think that I learned now that Taker and Kane don't have powers, I think we're due to some American Badass Taker and American Badass Kane, aka the Sons of Destruction.
Okay, I can see that. Oh, so okay. Like just complete depowered Brothers of Destruction roll out on motorcycles, and we just do this. And...
Or Corporate Glenn and Corporate Mark, whatever works best.
Well, how about Isaac Yankum?
How about Isaac Yankum and Mean Mark? Let's just go roll all the way back. What was he? What was he in Ohio Valley? Was he like the executioner or something? Like I got a DVD of his Ohio Valley. It's just like he still moves like Kane, but he's just a big guy with gloves.
Unabomb.
Unabomb. Yeah. That's right. Unabomb. Wow.
No. He becomes the Christmas creature or whatever.
Santa Claus. Xanta
Claus?
It's the
perfect time of the year. No, Xanta
Claus.
No,
that is not Xanta Claus. It's much different than
that's Balls Mahoney. That's Balls Mahoney, yeah. Right? Yeah. That's true.
No. Wow. Sorg, I don't know if you've seen it before. It's a human Christmas tree. Like a wrestling Christmas tree.
Where is this?
It was for Jerry Lawler's old friend,
it's
right?
Continually it's like, the most... If we can't tell, we're vamping for time for somebody in LA traffic by
it's
now.
Like the, it's like the Christmas personification of the gobbledygooker.
I think I'd like to see the gooker versus the Christmas creature. I think I want to see that match.
Oh, battle for the holidays. Take that, Krampus.
Don't put out your decorations till after Black Friday.
What was that, Garza?
It's his anniversary that's coming up with the Survivor Series, so. Maybe we're
going to
get the Gooker back.
There you go. There we go. We always forget about that debut that happened that year. That was a big year for me with the Survivor Series. It was also on Thanksgiving. I think that made
we should just have another giant egg And when the giant head opens, it's just Eva Marie.
Whatever happened to Max Moon? No, I don't even want to venture down that. He has a cane, and he... Wait, was that Max Moon? It was a different guy
for a minute.
That was Cohen. Yeah, no, he got taken out and couldn't help Prince Puma retain the...
Yeah. I mean, if only he had a jetpack, right, guys? But anyways, also...
Aerostar stole it.
Patron, Ed Burke... Shit, you're right. Learned that he still loves and really missed the cheesy supernatural gimmicks, as we saw this week and discussed earlier. Also from the Facebook, Hooven, Ryback rules as usual. Carlin's with the Taz, but Bobby F. J Town learned that Bray Wyatt can now conjure video package from the depths of the production truck. side note, I learned I love Buddy Cop Dan Hooven. Dean Ambrose.
I think he'll take that sword
because they had the tag match and they had to build a team against the evil challenge from the Bray Wyatt family for the Halloween edition of SmackDown, and there was just like a very, it was like the end of I want to say like Billy Madison or something, where like everybody comes out of the woodwork to help Billy beat the bad guy, basically, right? like the odd cast of characters from the rest of the movie just pops out and says, "I'll help you, Billy," or whatever your character is in this movie. Like that was Dean Ambrose showing up, and Ryback just like slams a bunch of rapes, like a bunch of weights, and says, "Yeah, I'll help you. Big guy's in." You know, I mean, like,
so,
stuff like
wait,
that.
Wait, hold on, Sorg. I haven't watched SmackDown yet. I was actually going to. I heard it was good.
Sorry, spoilers.
Did they just do the scenes from Ready to Rumble? Where it's Jimmy King and Gordy looking for a crew?
They did. I think they did.
They went to Goldberg in the gym, and John Cena's in the background being weird, awkward 90s John Cena. And Goldberg's like, "Jimmy King's flying by me, but I'm not going to help you guys out." And then he just drops the weights.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, I knew I'd seen that in a movie somewhere. And it was really funny because they kind of did the opposite thing with the Survivor Series build-up, right, on Raw. Like, which,
well, I mean,
by the way, I don't mind.
We did have Big E and Kofi summon Xavier Woods.
When I heard that trombone, I was so happy. Who hasn't gone yet? We got from the chat room, Alice Carr has learned that miracles still happen, and by that he means a pair of ice creams can actually win wrestling matches. I think that was from the indie stuff this weekend, right? Anybody else that we didn't get to yet? I don't know. We just went off everything. Oh, yeah. Yes, sir, in the corner.
My wife wanted me to pass along what she learned from wrestling this week. She learned that Seth Rollins' hair and high altitude do not get along.
Really? Poof? Poof.
I assume it's because the blonde hair dye has a lower density than the black hair. It's all relating to like high tensions and surface pressure and all that stuff. So it's fine. It's all very technical.
Guys, this might be one of the most fun Mayhem shows I've had in a long time. Thank you, everybody. This has been your Wrestling Mayhem Show. You can join us, check out other conversations, check out the Midweek Wars, the Raw Wrap-Ups, if you can't get enough of this, at WrestlingMayhemShow.com. You can drop us a line also at the phone number 412-206-WMS0. I'd love to hear your voice. And sometimes it's an audition for you to get on the show. You can also drop us a line to Good Times.
Good Times
at WrestlingMayhemShow.com. And please follow us on the Twitters at Mayhem Show, on Facebook, on Google Plus, on the Facebook group for Wrestling Mayhem Show. We have a lot of great discussions there. Please share us on Reddit. We like friends of us there on Reddit to share our things. Apparently, that's a really good thing to do. Thank you, Mainstream Matt.
1T.
What's that?
1T.
1T.
Actually, well, 2, but 1. It's...
What?
Very technical.
It's 2 T's, 1 at the end.
That's right. Writing for us, thankfully, on WrestlingMayhemShow.com around Thursday every week, and around the indies on IndieWrestling.us.
Mondays.
For that, yes.
Yep.
Catch up with the weekend. Also, the voice of Inspire Pro Wrestling, Eamon Baton.
Hello. Yes, we just came off of a big event this past weekend. Yes, and we're going right into more stuff this next weekend with Fun Fest, which will be a very great weekend of events. I think we brought up Wu-Tang Clan in the on the gold, and we're actually technically kind of sharing a stage with them this weekend, which is cool.
Are you guys opening for Wu-Tang Clan?
Are you opening for Zach RZA?
Zach RZA. Yes. No, it will be really fun. Go check us out if you're going to be there around the Austin area.
I technically opened for Sponge one time. And that's a band I'll tell you about on our when we tell you about the 90s on that podcast, Eamon.
So. Yes. So, the podcast that will absolutely now happen.
Yes, absolutely. Mad Mike's in Poughkeepsie, New York. Rory Brand, this is his future endeavor letter he got from WWE.
I do. I actually, keep it taped to my back whenever I go out, just so people know, hey, Vince McMahon fired me once.
Listen, I may not have a lot of long employment opportunities, but I did get fired by a billionaire. And also, I put it on my resume.
Several,
several billionaires. Several. Oh, yeah, there's another one, too. But there, I mean, that letter isn't as coveted, is it? I don't know. Is there a song? I don't. Anyway. That's all. Off air. And from El Paso, Texas, he's the guy behind thewrestlingrevolution.com. Thank you for joining us, Garza. Cashing in your patron in the bank.
Yes. Yeah, thank you, guys. I'll see you next time. There's a Lucha we would talk about.
certainly. A blast to have you on here. Thank you, everybody. I'm at Sorgatron on the Twitters. And check out everything at sorgatronmedia.com. Thank you so much, everybody, joining us here in the chat room, live.wrestlingmayhemshow.com, every Tuesday. Around 9 p.m. Eastern Time, more or less. We might be talking about wrestling. We might be talking about the Spice Girls. Only the Patreons will really know. So will we see you guys next time. Mayhem Show out. This show is a member of the Sorgatron Media Podcast Network. Find out more at sorgatronmedia.com.